Welcome to the first of our event showcasing Bristol Ageing Better evaluation led by the University of West of England. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Carly Urbanski and I'm the head of the program here. And I'm so excited to be here to introduce this event because I've been a part of the BAB program since 2016 when I was working specifically on the age-friendly initiative. And I've been able to see the program grow, adapt, and become what it is today. So it's so special to be here right now and see the final evaluation all coming together. I want to start out by thanking each and every one of you for being here today and taking the time out of your day. It means so much to us that you're interested in learning from the BAB program and hearing the analysis done by Matt, his team, and the community researchers. Just a little bit about BAB before we start. BAB's original goal was to bring individuals and organizations together around a common theme, which was addressing social isolation and loneliness in older people. We are one of 14 areas around the UK that have the same funding from the National Lottery Fund, so we feed into that larger network. Our approach has been based around having a core team sitting within Age UK Bristol, which would run the program on an operational and strategic level. And this core team was dedicated to pushing everything forward, managing work behind the scenes. And then the goal was to work with a wider partnership and specifically some primary delivery partners across the city who would deliver the work on the ground. And this approach has been a key element of the BAB program from the start, with partners bringing different knowledge, experience, and expertise to the table. And we feel strongly that this approach has worked extremely well and been part of the success of the wider BAB program. Even with most of our projects winding down over the last year, we have managed to continue to engage with our wider partnership and feed off their energy and work across the city. It's so exciting to us that we've been able to maintain those relationships and connections and continue to look at how we work together going forward. While most of the projects and groups were winding down, one of our key projects has been our age-friendly work across the city. And this work is really only getting started, even though we've been doing it for so long, but it's just amazing where it can go and the reach it has. It has been one of the goals from day one for BAB to make sure that we embed best practice around age friendly into the city and work to make Bristol more age friendly, keeping with the key themes listed by the World Health Organization. And it's been amazing to see how far we've come in this work and the momentum that keeps gaining and to create our plans going forward. And these October events, they mark the beginning of our journey of sharing all of the learning from BAB, whether it's age-friendly or all of our other projects so far. So it's a really exciting time for us to see where it's come from, especially people who have been here from the beginning with us from day one. And it's amazing to have the supports continue. And this is what we've been building up over the last 5.5 years at this point. So amazingly, throughout the BAB partners, we have actually worked with 21,000 older people across the city, which is just such an incredible reach. We are so proud of that. And what's especially compelling is that now we have strong evidence that BAB had a positive impact on the well-being of older people who participated over the years. And the UWE evaluation team will go into more detail about their findings shortly, so I'll stop there. But it's just incredible for us to see this achievement for BAB and everyone involved. It definitely shows that all of our hard work has paid off. So thank you again for being here today. And I'll now hand you over to Laura, who will explain more about the event.
Thank you, Carly. For those of you who don't know, my name's Laura Thacker. And I'm joint head of program for BAB, have been covering Carly for the past year while she's been on maternity leave. So I'm just going to run through the agenda for today and a couple of housekeeping things. So today we'll be hearing from Matt Jones and Sheila McIntosh from UWE, who'll be giving us an overview of the key outcomes from the evaluation of BAB. We will be keeping everyone on mute today so that we can hear the speakers clearly. There will be a chance for questions directly after the presentation. So if you do think of something as we go along, then please write it in the chat box. The chat box will automatically send your questions to the BAB team rather than to everyone here today, just so that it doesn't distract us from the presentation. So once we've had our initial questions, we'll have about a 5 minute comfort break at around 11 o'clock. We'll be showing our BAB's first animation, which was released in 2015 by Aardman. And then after the break, BAB, UWE and the community researchers will be on hand to answer further questions that you might have. Please feel free to leave at 11 if you need to, just to kind of give you a chance if you do need to leave earlier. But we will be around after 11. Also, we have live captions today. So to turn this on and off, you use the CC closed captions button at the bottom of your screen. And also just to note that this event is being recorded, and that's just so that we can ensure it's available afterwards for everyone. So without further ado, I will hand over to Heather Wright. She's the patron for AGK Bristol, and she's going to say a few words about the start of the BAB journey. So Heather, do you want to unmute yourself?
Yep, that's me. Give me 1 second, just lost the place. So first I want to say thank you so much for inviting me to just say a few words at the beginning of this event. It's really been an enormous journey, and for those of us who were there at the beginning and those of us who have joined all along, it's really been a very exciting journey, and I think it's resulted in not only achieving its major objective of making us a better place to grow old, making Bristol a better place to grow old, also has uncovered some really important work and some important research, which I'm really proud that the team can share with, you know, people that were involved, also other people who may be able to learn from it. So I got involved after an event at the M Shed in Bristol, where when I was an executive producer at Aardman, I'd been talking about the power of co-creation and communicating with large audiences. And the timing of this coincided with the launch of the National Lottery Ageing Better programme. And it was Kay, actually, who was at the time working for Bristol City Council, who came to find me afterwards with her colleague Geraldine and said, would I be interested in getting involved? And I was keen, and Aardman was keen to be involved too. One of the events that kind of sticks in all our minds really clearly was a national lottery briefing in Exeter, which was a few weeks later. And most cities sent a couple of people to find out more. But there was no mistaking from the beginning how serious Bristol was. We turned up in our coach and occupied about three tables. So the passion and commitment to older people's engagement from Bristol was evident to everybody from the get-go. It was really was always about co-creation, about working together, about doing everything together as a city. We also had numerous representatives that day from all our voluntary sector organisations who all came together, representatives of our city's older people, the council, and of course I was there too. And we had enthusiasm and commitment from all sectors from the outset. Just wanted to say a few thank yous before we get into the main business of the day. So the winning bid, which outlined the BAB programme, was pulled together by a team of fantastic people. But there were a few people who are worthy of a special mention. The first one is Judith Brown. Hello, Judith. She was the chair of Bristol Older People's Forum at the time. And she worked a lot with Guy Robertson from Quantitative Ageing Associates. Alan Carpenter, who was our Chair of Trustees, and Mark Baker, who was our CEO from Age UK Bristol. And of course, Kay herself from the council was really involved and engaged. Once we were up and running though, there was then another amazing team who brought the programme to life, and a few people there really need a separate mention too. And they are Adam Rees, who was the first director of the BAB programme, Ruth Richardson, Carly and Laura, thank you, Carly Urbanski and Laura Thacker. And of course, the entire BAB team, past and present. We've had quite a lot of change in staff over the 6 years, but they've consistently brought high energy, commitment and enthusiasm. And of course, none of it would have been possible were it not for the older people who have been engaged throughout the programme in designing, delivering and monitoring the work. We've even had older people trained by UWE as community researchers. So what is the key thing that made the BAB programme work so well? Primarily, we think it was the whole system nature of the programme that pulled all the city stakeholders in the city together. It did bring some innovative new ideas to the city, but also it was developed to focus on creating the conditions for change and things like building an age-friendly city, grew out of that, the conditions for change were right. Creating a living legacy was always part of the programme, and making it sustainable beyond the length of the funding was always part of the plan. And this, you know, I'm really pleased to hear about the seventh year and all the work that we're going to hear about today, which will be taken forward. There's never been an approach like this funded by the National Lottery before, with the 14 programmes, as Carly mentioned, across the country and funded for 6 years. You know, it brings us a huge amount of pleasure to bring the learning from the Bristol programme to everyone in the city and beyond. So I'll hand it over back now to the BAB team. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Heather. Okay, so now we will hear from Matt Jones and Sheila from UWE. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. So today's presentation, after setting the scene, we're going to give an overview of BAB, the wider context and the delivery of the programme. We're going to focus on the impacts of the projects on the lives of older people in the city before pointing towards some implications from the evaluation. And this is part of the first part of three sessions, and there'll be two more to come in the following weeks. Over the past 5 years, the BAB programme has recorded work with over 20,000 older people, about a third of whom were experiencing ongoing and intense feelings of loneliness. John's daughter and family had moved away from Bristol. He'd be going out less and less, and often found himself sitting in front of the television for long periods of time. Irene lives alone after her husband had passed away. Her condition makes her feel tired and unable to get about. She has memory problems and often doesn't feel confident to try new things. Veronica feels that her community hasn't got anything to bring her community together. During lockdown, Shanaz feels that the world has shut her out. She wants to do more in her neighbourhood. These experiences reflect a major social issue in Bristol. A growing body of research has identified damaging health consequences of social isolation and loneliness, to the point that we now recognise it as an important public health issue. People who are lonely are more likely to visit health services, use more medication, more likely to fall, and may go into residential care earlier. Older adults are particularly vulnerable to loneliness and isolation due to ageism and changes in social connections in later life. Loneliness and isolation has received a surge of attention in recent years. Age UK's work to map loneliness shows that it's closely linked to social deprivation and poverty. In many ways, loneliness is a consequence of social inequality and therefore part of a much bigger issue. But studies such as the Fishponds Neighbourhood Assets Research conducted by the BAB community researchers also shows that place really matters. While some neighbourhoods support human connections, others do not. Loneliness then is complex, it's sensitive, and since the early 2000s, BAB has been a city where the issue has been a subject of active debate in older people's arenas. Sheila.
Thanks, Matt. I'm going to give you just a brief background about the aims of BAB and the aims of the evaluation and the context that BAB was operating in. Can you have the next slide, Matt? So the aims were for more older people to have the amount and type of social contact that they wanted to try and reduce isolation and loneliness, so that they could influence the decisions in their local area, so that they were able to contribute to their community in whatever way they wanted, through volunteering or belonging to a forum or group. But there were some additional outcomes that were needed, which was to use the evidence collected to influence and inform decision makers to ensure that future services in Bristol are better planned and more effective in reducing loneliness and isolation. But I think it was recognised right from the start that despite the substantial funding, that the scale of the issue was much greater than the amount that the funding could address. For example, we could have put all the BAB money into transport and mobility alone, and it wouldn't have begun to change that. So that was something that had to be left out of the BAB programme. If we could have the next slide, Matt. So there was a systems approach, and with all these interconnected, these four interconnected aims. The first one was the wider conditions, the strategic policy and culture change in the city. The second one was changing how services work, especially the operation of health and social care services. The third was building community capacity with a really strong neighbourhood focus. And the final one was to support individuals to have one-to-one work and group work. We have the next slide, please, Matt. So it was all part of a connected system, but underlying it were a whole load of things that were going on in nationally and in Bristol itself that were going to have an effect on the programme. So I'm just going to run through some of those. Haven't got time to go into any of them in any depth, but this diagram lays out some of those factors. And the biggest one that impacted BAB was austerity. Because central government funding over the last decade has been cut really considerably. Bristol lost 78% of its central government grant over the last decade. And city services like housing, supporting people, environment, regulatory services, cultural heritage, public health, all bore the brunt of those cuts. Social care was largely protected to safeguard vulnerable children and adults, but it didn't get the resources required to meet the needs of an ageing population or the increasing numbers of younger people with long-term needs, plus the increasing costs of care. So over the period that BAB was getting started, there was actually a 14% reduction in the numbers of people aged over 65 receiving community support, and about a third of a reduction in those who were getting home care. And nationally, probably about one in five people are not getting the care that they and support that they need. And inevitably, that's going to add to the numbers of people who are isolated and lonely. And it makes it more difficult for carers to take part in activities. Austerity also affected the voluntary sector. In 2010, they got about 40% of their income from the city council, particularly the organisations that worked in the most deprived areas of the city. So the cuts to funding hit them really hard. So for Age UK Bristol, as the lead organisation, they had coordinated the bid, but they had to ensure that the allocation of BAB funding to the different projects was scrupulously fair. Because the voluntary sector was under so much pressure. But I think with austerity hasn't been totally negative. It's forced people to think differently, to look at alternative ways of operating, and it's brought together people who'd probably not collaborated before. So I think there's been some really good things that have happened over the last 10 years. Over the same period, health and social care has begun to change quite substantially and to try and integrate their services. And it's really because of changing needs. Many health conditions are now chronic and long-term, like obesity, diabetes, arthritis, dementia, mental health. They're not things that you can go into hospital and get cured and come out again. They're things that need long-term management. And they take account of about 70% of health expenditure nowadays. As Matt has said, loneliness and isolation in itself has a big impact on health. So the ultimate aim is to make services more preventative and to narrow the gap between the areas of the city that are richest and poorest. But it requires quite a radical change in focus from what makes us ill and frail to what keeps us healthy and active. And it puts a lot of responsibility on individuals to alter their diet, to do more exercise, to take up new activities. And they're quite difficult to sustain without support, and it's quite difficult to get going on without support. So that's sort of underlying the BAB programme. And it's been quite difficult for local areas to deliver the health and social care changes at the scale required or the speed required when services are under funding pressure. And I think there are other important factors that are influencing BAB that I haven't got time to go into, but the shifts towards localism, the election of mayors, had a really big impact, I think, particularly in the early stages of BAB when there was tremendous support from the first mayor. There's now a drive towards integrating long-term planning and the one city plan, which I know BAB has had an influence on. And there's also a shift towards asset-based approaches in many aspects of local strategy. And it's not just about funding. It's about people's own capacity and the resources within the community and how people can help themselves. So it's exactly those assets that BAB was designed to help and support. So I'm now going to hand back to Matt.
Thank you. So let's take an overview of the delivery of the programme and how it actually panned out in overview. Oops. So BAB funding was split across a wide range of projects. The 5.9 million in this pie chart shows that the project was split very diversely. If we take a more simplified view using the programme themes, you can see that the greatest share of the resources went towards community-based and individual support projects, themes 2 to 4, delivered by many agencies across the city. BAB then has been a large-scale initiative involving nearly every agency with a concern in the area. One notable feature, if you just look at those figures, is that for every 10 participants, there was one volunteer taking part in this programme. That's a remarkable ratio that points towards the level of public engagement, the volunteer support skills of the agencies, and the support needs of many of the participants. BAB was also a programme that involved older people from in decision making throughout its processes. This chart shows that older people were engaged right from the inception. BAB recorded 921 attendances at 323 events in the first 4 years of the programme. The chart also shows points where large numbers of older people took part in events in the Bristol Age-Friendly City consultation process. Taking a bit of a closer look at the demographics of people who take part in the programme then, you can see here that there were more females than males. That's quite a common feature of programmes of this nature. The programme appeared to engage people from a wide range of ethnic backgrounds, reflecting the city's diversity in this age group. And the programme engaged groups that might experience loneliness or other forms of disadvantage. So there was evidence that it was reaching the kinds of people that the programme hoped to do. It's quite hard to estimate what the reach of BAB has been, but we think that between 2015 and 2020, BAB directly reached between 1 in 10 and 2 in 10 people over the age of 50 experiencing intense loneliness in Bristol. However, this figure makes a number of assumptions about population data, about measures of loneliness, and it doesn't include participants who engaged but were not recorded, or those who indirectly benefited. So that ratio could be higher. So what changed for people who are taking part? At the outset, BAB used a questionnaire developed with national specialists. It used 12 standardised measures and an approach to completing the questionnaires at the beginning and later on, at a baseline follow-up approach. These questionnaires have been a matter of contention. For example, the approach doesn't work well with the projects which have been directed at systems and strategy change. It just doesn't capture that effects of those programs. And it's not usually appropriate for projects that are working with people who have cognitive issues or are extremely vulnerable. And I should add that we haven't been completely reliant upon this information. For instance, the BAB community researchers have led on qualitative research with many of the projects to capture a more in-depth picture. What I'm going to look at is the more quantitative aspect just now. So the first set of results go to the heart of the programme. They cover two measures of loneliness, mental well-being, health-related quality of life, the health barometer, and both of which of the latter are widely used measures in clinical settings. The results show statistically significant change for all of these measures. And when we looked at different groups, we found that all of these positive changes applied to those who scored as intensely lonely at the beginning of the program. In other words, these results apply to individuals experiencing the highest levels of social and emotional isolation. The evaluation measures also covered a wide range of markers for social contact and participation. They included people's ability to direct activities, to influence decisions, to volunteer and give unpaid help. The findings showed statistically significant changes for all but one of these measures. And in most instances, the changes were highly statistically significant. The exception of improved contact with children, family and friends was where there was no change. And that's possibly because those contacts are quite fixed in people's lives, or for some people, they're actually losing loved ones. And so those contacts are becoming fewer. We then asked, were there any differences in the outcomes between projects? And to do so, we took the 12 measures to examine the pattern of outcomes where we had good data that was available. This is quite a complex picture, but basically it shows that in the green boxes, there was positive statistically significant change, and the grey boxes show where there was no evidence of change. But I'll explain a bit more fully about what this means, and it's easier to summarise basically. So really there's a general pattern. The intensive one-to-one projects tended to work with people with higher levels of need and showed greater and stronger direct impacts on self-reported health. Meanwhile, the community capacity projects tended to be more preventative, and they showed stronger impacts upon participation, co-design, decision-making. There was quite weak evidence of change for some projects, and that could be because we had low questionnaire numbers. There are problems with the questions themselves. There could be the high levels of need of participants or ineffective project design and delivery. Notably, the community development projects did show impacts on social connections, well-being, loneliness and health. We thought that the community development projects could improve social connections, but we didn't expect direct effects on self-reported health. this is a relatively unusual thing in most research. It should be noted that this wasn't the case for all of the community development projects. Some we found stronger evidence than for others. Another way of looking at this whole set of information is to ask, what were the differences in outcomes for groups of participants, different groups of people? In summary, the younger age groups, people aged 50 to 69, were more likely to show improvements for health, loneliness, and volunteering than the older age groups, those who are 70 plus. But it should be emphasised that the 70 plus group did show a range of positive changes. For instance, in their ability to influence decisions. The positive effects were clearer for females than for males. This could be because we had lower numbers of males who were taking part in the questionnaire, and so it made it harder to detect change. Those who are living alone had similar outcomes to those who were living with others. And other disadvantaged groups showed a strong pattern of positive outcomes, including for those who had a long-standing illness, a disability, or caring responsibilities. There was a weaker pattern of outcomes for those living in areas of high multiple deprivation and for people from BAME groups. We looked at how the outcomes compared to the other 13 Ageing Better projects taking place nationally. What this chart shows is that for the key outcomes, the overall pattern of positive change is actually very similar. What the chart doesn't illustrate is that BAB participants on average tended to be more lonely and had poorer health at the start of their engagement. And also compared to other areas, the BAB evaluation gathered a much more comprehensive set of outcome evidence about people's involvement in decision-making, their volunteering and their co-production. So we've got a much broader picture of what changed for people. Okay, so I promise this is the final chart. We also have been looking at what happens in change over time. So while you might hope for positive change in the short term, we know that often for many of these sorts of projects, these changes are just not sustained over time. So using a self-complete postal questionnaire after 6 months of engagement, this chart shows that the overall effects of the projects have continued to be positive regarding their impact on self-reported loneliness. So what does all this mean in terms of the changes for individuals? You may remember that I introduced these people earlier on. Well, for John, through the Community Development Navigators, for the Community Navigators project, John was supported to join the fishing club. He went on to volunteer with the group, showing adults and children with learning disabilities how to fish. Irene's memory difficulties have not gone away, but she's been supported to try a range of activities that she would never have done normally, and she's starting to have social events across the week. To encourage others to get more involved in their community, Veronica from Oldbury Court took an active role in neighbourhood door knocking as part of a community development project and built on local interest to set up a sports club. Shanaz, a keen cook, has helped the Bristol Meets the World project with its online cooking shows during lockdown. The costs and benefits of interventions to reduce social isolation are inevitably at the forefront of a lot of planning concerns locally. So, thinking about cost effectiveness and social value is an important way of looking at the program. We've mapped five leading areas of social value that arise from the program. And you can see here that, first of all, the direct benefits to older people in terms of their health, their well-being and social connections, this is the area which figures first. But there are other areas where there are direct benefits. For the adult and social care system, the better direction of services, the reduced pressures on services are clearly a leading factor. There are direct benefits which we can see and quantify very clearly to the volunteering for communities and the third sector. But there are other less tangible forms of social value coming out from the programme, for example, with service innovation. So, what are some of the implications moving forward from all of this? Loneliness is woven into the social fabric of Bristol. It requires long-term and concerted political attention. The work of BAB has shown a range of feasible policy solutions that the third sector can contribute in this area. BAB has shown that Bristol is part way along a journey where people show, older people, show that they can direct action. There is insight, there's expertise, there's organisation that citizens themselves can bring here to shape services and community action that's more effective and appropriate to meet their needs and their interests. For commissioners and service developers, there's little demand to create loneliness services as such. Nobody looks for a loneliness service. But many initiatives need to be loneliness minded, such that they don't inadvertently widen inequalities between groups, or that they fail to take opportunities where they exist, or compound the problem inadvertently, often when acting under the greatest pressure to get things done. Initiatives that are friendly to older people are likely to be friendly to everyone, as evidenced by the intergenerational aspect of many of the BAB projects. The integration of health and social care clearly needs to build in voluntary sector expertise and imagination, particularly in place-based community development and social inclusion. For local independent charitable funders, where cash is limited, some priorities include stimulating action and debate through microfunding, through the training programs and networking schemes. And finally, community and service developers can use the BAB test and learn method to create better run and more scalable projects. We'll be picking up on some of these implications a bit further in the next two sessions over the next 2 weeks. And you can find out more on the BAB Learning and Evaluation Hub. I'd like to thank a wide range of people who worked and supported the evaluation of Bristol Ageing Better. And I think we've now got time to take some questions.
Brilliant. Thank you, Matt. Can you all just give a thumbs up if you can hear me? Because I think I was a bit quiet earlier. Okay, thank you. Yeah, we have had a couple of questions coming through. A couple about community development. I think I'm going to ask Sheila a question first, because obviously Matt's just been doing lots of talking. So Sheila, so you outlined the background pressures on the BAB programme. How has the public sector engaged with the programme, and do you think there's evidence that the positive outcomes from the programme will be supported in the future?
Well, I think, I mean, I came in to do a distinct piece of work looking at the underlying context. So I was mainly interviewing people who'd been involved in the early development of BAB. And obviously, at that point, there was an enormous amount of cooperation from a wide range of organisations, because I talked to a lot of the people at quite senior level in the different organisations who were supporting, say, the community navigators, etc., and from the voluntary sector. So it was definitely happening then. I think I need to pass it over to Matt, because he's taken that on and will know what's happening now as the programme moves forward.
Yes, I think that one of the big shifts, of course, has been with austerity in the public sector, particularly local government, that the capacity that was there at the beginning to be fully engaged became extremely stretched, particularly as the programme progressed. So I think that it's been a case, I think people I've interviewed have described as just having to hang on to those people within local government, many of whom have moved positions and there's been reorganisation, in order to keep that dialogue going. I think one of the sort of most difficult things was that the programme was designed in mind with the neighbourhood forums across the city. Those went around the time of the inception of the programme. And so I think that posed a real challenge for the team to think, how were they going to best connect in with the structures within the city? I think there are other challenges as well. For example, linkages, strategic work on coordinating and stimulating community development had to work with the City Council's community development team and find ways to best connect up in an environment that's changing quite fast. So I think there's an overall picture, really, of people all doing their best, but in a context that's quite pressurised overall.
Thank you. And we've had a couple of questions about community development. So what do you think, either of you, what do you think were the main factors contributing to the outcomes of the most successful community development projects?
So I think, first of all, it's important to just be aware, and we'll come back to community development in our third session, that typically community development projects work best when they have a long duration to run, and the 3-year duration, 2 years for some projects, was short, very limited. Within that time scale, then, to do work effectively, it seems that those agencies that had bigger capacity to get behind the projects, the agencies that were able to employ good project management techniques, particularly in converting the resources that are available into action within a short period of time. I think there is a potential that the pressure perhaps distorted some of the core values of community development, which typically prefer to work from a basis where communities themselves have the time to take on and identify the needs that they see as important. When working under pressure, I think community development workers then often have to and are forced to make forced actions to move forward on activities. So there could be a bit of a distortion here, that those community development projects that were more active and decisive in moving forward with core activities are those ones that produced better evidence of change. But perhaps they were also the ones which were not able to engage in the kind of ideal consultations that community development workers often aspire to. I think they were faced with some real tensions, therefore.
Thank you, Matt. And as you say, we'll be going into a bit more detail in the last of our events this October on community development, so can talk in more detail about it then as well. Okay, we've also had a question about loneliness. So given that the evidence from government reviews has shown that younger people are supposed to be the loneliest age group, do you think there's scope to use evidence from BAB to inform projects aimed at younger people too?
Absolutely. I think one of the things that arose from the programme was when projects were contracted, they obviously had to report upon the effects of what they were doing with regard to people who are age 50 plus. And in some ways that then created a bit of an artificial divide for quite a lot of the projects, which did seek to work in a very intergenerational way. There were a lot of projects which were working across those generations and were delivering benefits for younger age groups. So I think first of all, there's there's an awareness for a lot of the agencies concerned that the interests of people taking part were in projects which were very cross-generational, which weren't targeted just at older people, and therefore in that respect would bring in people from younger age groups who could take part. I think that was one of the key bits of learning, and also one of the difficulties, because of course the funding, nature of the funding, was directed towards older people, but I think there's many benefits in these projects towards younger people as well.
Yeah.
Right. Thank you, Matt. Okay, then we've also had a couple of questions about Black and Asian minority ethnic communities. So we did have a couple of projects aimed at BAME communities. Do you think the findings suggesting from the BAB programme that there's more work needs to be done with men and also BAME communities in Bristol? Do you think that more work needs to be done there?
So the BME groups, I think that there's a complicated picture behind all of this, one of which is that some of the projects that were working with those groups were quite broad in their objectives, and they were often creating benefits which this questionnaire-based approach might have been missing out on. In other words, there are other positive things happening, but they're just not captured within the questionnaire format. There are other things that are going on in terms of how this questionnaire process was simply not the right fit for some of those projects, some of which were working in a more strategic and culture change way. We could be missing something here. I think one of the things which is quite hard to get at is some of the projects were very successful in engaging people who fitted the right sort of profile. They were people who may be living alone, who reported higher levels of of loneliness, but were not reporting change. So I think there's clearly more work needed in this area, not so much in terms of the BAB has shown a very great level of success in working with the right agencies, but it clearly shows that there's more work to understand what can be done to create more impact.
Can I come in on that as well?
Yeah,
sure. In talking to people who'd been involved from various organisations, they pointed out that, you know, for the community researchers, for example, it was a very white middle class group in many respects. And that is quite common in initiatives like this, that they're the people that come forward to do that type of work. And that obviously then has a slight influence on things. And trying to bring in people, and I know that we had a meeting with some of the other groups around the country that are developing their own Ageing Better programs, and they'd taken a slightly different approach in terms of what they'd called, for example, their community researchers, so that it was more open and welcoming and didn't seem to kind of need a certain level of expertise for people to join. So I think there is a lot of learning from the programme about how you can bring more people in from a varied background. And looking back to what the council used to do, there used to be an Older People's Partnership Board way back before 2010 and all the cuts. And that was very inclusive, and it brought in a lot of people from all the communities. And I think that maybe going back to that is what we need, is to engage those leaders from those communities at a level with local government to help initiate things more in local communities.
Okay, thank you both of you.
Would it be worth saying something a bit about the question about the males and females, men and women taking part?
Sure, yeah.
And I think this is looking at other programmes in this area, there were a fewer ratio of men involved in these projects is exactly what you see, both in the other Ageing Better programmes nationally, and in terms of a wide range of these third sector type initiatives. So it's a really common pattern. And there is clearly something that is quite gendered about the idea of people taking part in things that are called many of the community initiatives. So they clearly seem to be less attractive to men. Mm. But it is a complicated picture, because it could well be that there are other resources that men are able to draw upon, and therefore the there are higher levels of needs amongst women, and that this program is meeting those needs. But I think it is an ongoing national, probably an international issue with projects of this nature.
Brilliant, thank you. And we just probably have time for one more question before the break. So this one says, clearly we now have some learning that can guide us on the type of services that we should develop for older people. Did we learn about services that weren't so successful too?
Yeah, and I think that I think there's something about making a distinction between some of the initiatives were appeared to be they were valuable as test and learn initiatives where there's a learning and through the piloting process, but they were just too temporary, too small, and too transient to really get any traction. So some of those smaller scale initiatives, great for learning, but not so good for understanding or creating scalable impact. So I think that's one of the issues. And I think another key issue, which is perhaps less to do with the specific design of services, but more to do with getting the right fit with the delivery agency. Some agencies appeared better organized to pick up and run with projects, whereas others, probably because they were having challenges elsewhere in their organization, found themselves less able to pick up in a timely way the projects and the funding available and translate that into action. So looking quite carefully at the readiness of agencies to deliver projects seems to be really important here.
Brilliant, thank you very much. Sheila, did you have anything to add to that?
Well, just to say, to pick up on something Matt said earlier, it's having a project that perhaps only runs for, even the more successful ones, if it's only running for 2 years, perhaps isn't enough. It's that length of time that is needed to get something both off the ground and then really functioning effectively, and for the community to then take it on and to get it really established. It just takes time.
Totally agree, yeah. Okay, thank you very much to both of you. We are going to take a short 5-minute comfort break, but just before we do, I'm gonna run through a couple of things that just, if you could move to the next slide, please, Claire. Thank you. So as mentioned earlier, obviously today is the first in our series of events. So if you are interested in hearing more about all of the key findings in a bit more depth, and you haven't already signed up to the other events, then please do. On the 15th of October, so next Thursday, we'll be talking about older people as active citizens. And on the 22nd of October, the focus will be on building community assets. So the community development aspect of BAB. If you can't make every session, then don't worry, all of our events will be available afterwards on the BAB YouTube channel. And we will send links around with the slides and everything after this event today. We have also revamped our website, as Matt mentioned earlier. So we have a new learning and evaluation hub where we'll be uploading all of the final reports from UWE and the community researchers, and also any additional learning from BAB outside of the formal evaluation. So if any of you have to rush off now, then that's absolutely fine, but a huge thank you for coming today. And after the break, BAB, UWE, and we think we have some of the community researchers here as well, will be around to answer any further questions. We have had quite a few through, so there's a few topics that we'd like to cover afterwards. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce our ad break, featuring Aardman's animation. So this animation, it really set the scene for the BAB programme in 2015. I'm sure many of you might have seen it already, but for those who haven't, please enjoy.
I found when I was independent, working, looking after my family, and then they move away, and suddenly you find you're alone.
It's very easy sometimes, isn't it, to sort of think that I'm old now, don't want to do anything, just give up, you know. Your life, you can just sort of see it going by. It's almost waving at you.
Well, I got a scooter. It's a nice little thing because it's only two levers, one to go forward, one to go back. And then if you want to stop, you just take your hand off the lever.
I'm not sort of in the lonely field because I interact with people all the time.
You go in a small shop and somebody will always talk to you, won't they? Small shops. I mean, we get people coming here, they don't know each other, and they'll start chatting, say hello and that, and then all of a sudden they're having a conversation for quite a while.
When you're depressed, isolated and down, you can't see a future. But I did quite a lot of voluntary work. I can't believe how my life has changed. It's constantly getting better. Yeah. Woo!
I can't venture too far, can I?
No.
I got to be behind Mike most of the time.
Yeah. I'll keep falling over.
When you're getting old, keep your body active. That's the most important thing. Keep your body active. Even if you have to take up the Hoover and Hoover the house. That's what I do.
I would urge anyone over the age of 55 to live your life. Because we might have quite a few years ahead of us yet. So let's make the best of them.
Have Bianca, because we have an age-friendly question here. Okay, so
Hello.
Did you receive the age-friendly question?
I did, yes. I think I've just got it here. So that was from Leeds, wasn't it? So it should I read out the question?
Oh yeah, so go for it.
Sure, so I think they've asked, we're inspired by your age-friendly business guide, thanks, which was part of your building condition change. How successful have you been in engaging larger businesses? So I just grabbed a copy of that in case anyone hasn't seen it. I've got quite a few copies left if anyone wants one sent out. So last year we created this toolkit. It's how many pages is it? Somewhere around 40 pages for businesses to support them to become age friendly. So it gave a brief overview of those eight domains of age friendliness as set out by the World Health Organization. Now, I would say that guide was largely aimed actually at smaller businesses. So it's more sort of what businesses could do. I mean, it mentioned sort of larger scale changes. So how you can make, if you have a venue, more make it more accessible, ideas for sort of volunteering programs that staff can do, but also just smaller things like get your staff signed up as dementia friends, that takes 5 minutes, or have some comment cards and kind of think about how you can actively support older customers without making assumptions. So, I mean, I think that was really beneficial to quite a lot of businesses that we got it into the hands of. We also, in there's 5 case studies, we showcased some businesses that are doing really good things around age friendliness. One of them was a much larger business. So one was Bristol Music Trust, which runs quite a lot of arts projects across the city, but particularly runs the Bristol Beacon, formerly Colston Hall. And we have actually since then we had some engagement with Bristol Airport, which is great. So they kind of completed our age friendly checklist and were working with us to become more age friendly. That unfortunately we were attending their kind of customer forums and bringing some older people along, and that has stopped due to COVID. There were a couple of big things that we had planned that have been put on hold. So we were hoping to do an age friendly business accreditation aimed at businesses of all sizes and also some age-friendly training. There's some quite immersive training that AGK and the Isle of Wight run, which we were hoping to deliver to sort of supermarkets and first bus, fire service, kind of big organisations like that, that would have made a real difference. Again, that has had to be put on hold because it's very interactive training, but they're looking at starting it virtually. Actually, we're going to be trialing that in December and hopefully be able to do that next year. I think we would really like to have some more contact with businesses of all sizes. I think there are quite a few things that COVID has thrown up, just to sort of put it briefly. I think the way that businesses operate has obviously changed hugely, and the way that people engage with businesses has changed. It does seem there is going to be a bit of a trend towards people using, in terms of retail, using more local businesses, which could be a really positive thing. I think, you know, you can, without meaning to sound too glib, there could be positives to the changes we're seeing in the retail sector and the challenges it's facing in making high streets more mixed use. And I know that Bristol City Council are keen to kind of work on high street regeneration, and hopefully age friendliness can be a part of that. So looking at how there can be more social opportunities with businesses. We have done some work during lockdown to get some messaging out to particularly retail spaces about how they can be age friendly during COVID. So things like, think about the fact that if people are queuing for long times, you might want to provide spaces for people to stop and rest. And again, we've seen kind of smaller independent businesses doing that actually. There's a garden centre near me that has like benches outside, which have been really popular, you know, and trying to remind people of things like, if you're moving entirely to contactless or cashless payments, that can exclude some people. And we've seen a lot of age-friendly changes. I mean, Matt mentioned about the kind of community support, certainly in terms of age-friendly neighbourhoods, that's something we can really capture. And again, in terms of businesses, then, you know, supermarkets allowing people to do their shopping over the phone, doing deliveries, kind of, you know, really having those priority hours, which, you know, only a couple of supermarkets had priority hours for older people before the pandemic. So I think that's all really positive stuff that we can capture. At the moment, it is a bit of a challenge. I mean, we're part of an age-friendly working group with a couple of areas in the UK, Thanet in Kent and East Lindsay, both of whom had age-friendly accreditation schemes before. So we can kind of work on, kind of build on their evidence from what's worked to launch ours, hopefully in the future. But it's very hard in terms of kind of pushing the how businesses can add social value, how they can actually work to reduce isolation and loneliness through kind of offering that social connection. I think it's a real challenge for social distancing, but it's a real challenge during a recession where businesses are just trying to stay solvent. So that's a bit of a ramble, but I think there are, you know, a lot of challenges, but also, you know, a lot of positives, a lot of silver linings that have come out of this that we can capture once we're able to start that more age-friendly work with businesses around age friendly, and hopefully work with some of those larger businesses. But I think the smaller ones may be the key to really kind of building that social connection and age friendly within communities in the city.
Thank you, Bianca. That was really, really helpful. Okay, we're going to skip back to the evaluation of BAB now. So we've had a question here. Looking at the age groups of people that we worked with. So has any learning come out of this about the varying needs of different age groups within the older people group? Obviously the needs of 50-year-olds might not be the same as those who are much older, sort of 90s. So do we have any learning from this, Matt or Sheila?
Yes, I think that a notable feature of a lot of the commissioned projects is that there was no explicit reference at the beginning, either in the requirements for them to apply to BAB or what they then went on to do, to make distinctions between the younger older people and older people. So I think a feature of a lot of the projects is that they didn't explicitly set out to focus on those the different ages within that whole bracket. There were some obvious exceptions, but for example, the care home work with care home and community development work, which by default would clearly work with the older age group. I think it was maybe one of the slightly missed opportunities in the whole commissioning process to actually try to develop a test and learn approach which would be highly geared towards the upper age groups. I think that that maybe in hindsight was a bit of a missed opportunity, particularly because there are differences, generational differences between 70 plus, 80 plus, 90 plus. So there are some real differences there, and accepting the projects which have explicit, working with those very older groups, those distinctions could have been explored more, I think.
Great, thank you, Matt. We've also had a couple of questions about community researchers. Mainly, I suppose, how the community researchers were engaged, how they were trained, and also whether they will continue. So Matt, I know you've been heavily involved in supporting the researchers over the last few years. So do you want to say a few words about how that process worked and whether they'll still continue?
Well, I wouldn't want to steal thunder from next week. So if for those of you who are able to make it or to see the recording of next week, you'll hear a lot more about all of that. So I think, shall we put that one over to next week?
Okay, we'll do that. Okay. What else have we had? We've also had... we've also had a question about better links with hospitals. So this one says, so we often signpost to Age UK and Silver Line, but that relies on the patient or family taking things forward. Whereas if we could directly refer to yourselves, I think it would be hugely beneficial. Okay, so this is a bit more generic. So for the projects, within BAB, so that they have mostly ended now, so we wouldn't usually be taking referrals for projects, but we can follow up with you afterwards about that. Actually, I think we'll capture who's asked the questions and catch up with you afterwards. Anything else we've missed or haven't talked about? Got something here about the BAB approach itself. So obviously we had a dedicated team to focus on partnership working. So either Matt or Sheila, do you think that the BAB approach itself was really important in securing these successful outcomes that you've talked about today?
I think one of the most obvious cases is around the Kickstart projects, which were small awards given to targeted at groups that were small, often informally constituted. And when we look at these similar micro funding schemes that have happened elsewhere, the problem for a lot of them is that the funding goes out and people are then get on with them and do something with that small pot of funding. What was really notable with the BAB program was that consistent ongoing coordination and support, the advice to people who are unsuccessful, the feedback, the opportunities to engage with other things taking place through BAB, all of that was coordinated at a central level. And that, if you like, amplified the benefits of that scheme. So if we take that as being an example of what a core team can do, is that they can amplify benefits which might otherwise be lost when you just have a host of individual little schemes running. Mm-hmm. The other aspect though of BAB in terms of the coordination function was that once it gets to a bigger level, there are some quite complex political issues going on about who has the right to convene, who has the authority to coordinate, the third sector being the vibrant beast that it is, where there's a multitude of different agencies all often forced to compete with one another. BAB as a program with its central coordination work had a tremendous job on to try to fairly work across that whole sector. So I think it's a huge area of difficulty, this, about how do you bring together a multitude of agencies to act in consort. Mm-hmm.
Did you have anything to add to that, Sheila?
Well, just that I think BAB made it a relatively simple process to apply for those grants, because for small organisations, it is very difficult to fill in huge, long application forms. So keeping that simple is really important. And certainly when I interviewed quite a lot of people who've been involved in the program, and Kickstart was one of the things that they picked out as being such a success. You know, just those small amounts of money can make a huge difference to an organization to just keep it going, keep kind of give it basic things like just buying a set of chairs, or, you know, it's just simple things can make an enormous difference to a small organization. So, but going forward, if Babbitt isn't there, who takes on that coordinating role, I think is really important. Mm-hmm. If a funding system like that was carrying on, because it does have to be fair, and it does have to have this simple process so it doesn't become too bureaucratic.
Brilliant, thank you both. Okay, well, I think we'll probably wrap up now, but please do contact us if you have any further questions or if we didn't get to your question today. I want to say a huge thank you to all of our speakers and for everyone coming today. It's been great to see some familiar faces and also some new ones. We hope that you will be able to come along to the next events. And we will send through lots of information after this event. So anything that we've talked about today, we can share with you. And yes, a huge thank you from the BAB team for coming.